The Toccata and Fugue in D minor is our first major piece of the evening. Da-da-dum! Da-da-da-da-dum! Bum! I hear the toccata as a giant recitativa, a huge introduction to the more wonderful, in a way, for me, the piece which is the fugue, which proves that Bach was as great a mathematician as indeed he was a wonderful musician.
Thank you.
This instrument is arguably the finest English romantic organ, not just in the Commonwealth, but in the world. There are many imitations of this instrument, but this is rather Mecca for the English romantic player.
Do we know who made it?
Yes, it was built by Arthur Harrison in 1912. It is an instrument of approximately 5,000 pipes. It weighs, get ready, good Lord, 35 tons. And with me seated on it, it's a worry. I won't even speculate. It took probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 200,000 man hours to build and is valued at nearly £750,000. It is irreplaceable, however. Every pipe was handmade, every bit of mechanism that makes it work was handmade to fit the ambiance, the acoustic of this glorious space, like a seamless glove.
Do you feel plugged into history when you play in a building like this?
Absolutely. To be locked into this building for the entire night, to hear the things that pass through this space, to feel every hair on the back of my head stand straight up. During my rehearsals earlier this year, I wandered down to the west end of the church, and high on the north wall there, I spotted a wonderful monument embedded in the north wall to Sir William Penn, who was the father of William Penn, the founder of Pennsylvania. And of course, I lived in Philadelphia for many years and have a great affection for that place. Just underneath that memorial, that monument, is the most beautiful medieval glass window, stained glass window. It is the only bit of medieval glass in this building, I'm told, and I hope that is right. In any case, after investigating it a bit and spending a lot of time looking at it and enjoying it, I did notice that things were a bit amiss with it. It didn't fit to any one design, and I discovered that Cromwell's armies visited here, not to attend a Carlo Curley recital, mind you, but to do damage to the fabric. And by Jove, they did not off. They tore it to bits, and the window was really decimated. They picked up the pieces after they had gone away and put it back together again in a completely different design. Nothing matches. It is an extremely beautiful collage of glass, which I would say is arguably far finer than what was there originally. So that is just one of the many exquisite features of this building. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no small breath of fresh air that I believe has been arranged for any instrument that fits as well as the little Chanson de Matin by Elgar. They say that organists are all frustrated singers, really. Well, we play an extremely mechanical instrument, as perhaps you know, but this little piece, this breath of fresh air, really works. Dum, dum, da, 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 da. I love the next bit. La, 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 da, 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 da. But particularly the next bit. La 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 da dum bum. La 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 la. Why don't I just try playing it for you? I think we're in. A very brief word only to say that Norman Cocker had a great double life. During the week, he played at a Manchester cinema, a big theater organ. And then, later in his life, he became the cathedral organist at Manchester Cathedral. And I would say to you, ladies and gentlemen, that I think one certainly did assist the other. He He's written a very fetching piece here. I'm going to begin the tuba tune on a tuba which appears on the great organ, which is manual 2 on this four-manual giant organ here of St. Mary Redcliffe. It's actually called a tromba stop, and it's a very smooth quality. But later on in the piece, you'll hear the mighty full swell organ come on, and then the great tuba, which is situated just up on this side, will come into play. Hope you'll enjoy listening, ladies and gentlemen, to the very singular tuba tune by Norman Cocker.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. The following selection is indeed a breath of fresh air. It's entitled Rondo Capriccio. This work actually shows a wee bit to the layperson particularly that the organ, really the pipes in an organ, speak at the same volume all the time. And to make the organ expressive, ladies and gentlemen, the pipes are enclosed in little rooms called swell boxes, which have movable open and shut louvers in front of the pipes, yeah? And basically, to make a short story longer or whatever, you can do all sorts of things to make music on the organ, but the three principal things are blending the stops together, right? Voice leading, which is the connecting of one note to the other, very important, of course, and working that ankle, making those swell pedals open, the swell louvers open and shut. This piece really demonstrates that device on the organ because Lemaire used the swell shutters to accent rum ta 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 tum cha dum brum ta 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 tum. Listen particularly to the last few pages, the two pages at the end, ladies and gentlemen, because you'll hear some very fanciful, very light work coming from both sides of this marvelous stereo effect organ here at Redcliffe. Let me play for you Rondo Capriccio.
Thank you.
you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, of course, one of the great uses of the organ is not certainly only as a concert instrument, even though that's my chosen field and the one which I adore very much indeed, but also, I would have to say that many of you certainly know and play in church on Sunday yourself, but it is used to accompany the service and to create an ambiance for worship and so forth. There's nothing I think that's more exciting than the sound of a very, very fine choir accompanied by a glorious organ. And to that end, now I would like to ask John Marsh and his choir to join me. Would you please give a warm Bristol welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the choir of St. Mary Redcliffe and their director of music, Mr. John Marsh. Please, John, thank you very much indeed.
was it inspired you to devote your life to this instrument?
There were really two organists on the face of this earth that I was very near to, very dear to, who were personal friends as well as mentors and teachers. The first was the American virtuoso Dr. Virgil Fox, who played for 20 years or so at New York's Riverside Church, the great church of the Rockefeller family, which was blessed with a magnificent organ. He did more perhaps for the organ in North America and certainly around the world via his gramophone recordings and so forth than any single organist has done in this century, I would dare say. At his recommendation, I traveled to England in the early 1970s and met Sir George Thalben Ball, who was my teacher and great friend for many years, the organist at London's Temple Church. And he had quite a track record, dear Thalben. He was at the Temple Church for over 60 years as organist and choir master. He had a great sense of humor with music. He was a virtuoso pianist, which meant that when he came to the organ, he had a wonderful piano technique, which was really quite extraordinary. But he also played with a certain style, which I've never heard since, really. And so between those two great influences in my musical life, I would like to think that their input, plus proper musical training, and having a great affection for singers and singing, I've often said that singers are the true musicians because they create everything biodynamically or organically, as they say in the health food store, you know. I listen to them. I'm mad for the orchestra. Virgil Fox once said to me when I lived in Philadelphia, he called everyone honey. He preluded everything, I'm sure even to the tax inspector, with honey, comma, you know. And he said to me, he said, honey, one thing you can learn, far more than taking organ lessons from me one day a week or 2 days a week up in New York and New Jersey in his house, he said, is to let me arrange for you to go in and hear the Philadelphia Orchestra with their guest conductors and with their principal conductor, the late Eugene Ormandy now. He said, please go in and sit in the back, under the gallery, out of the way, and listen to the orchestra prepare the great symphonies and that repertoire. And you know, he was so right, because going and listening to them prepare orchestras, as you perhaps know, certainly, and you do know, they listen to one another. The word blend is all important. And as I've said earlier, the organ is not a touch-sensitive instrument, and it is only by blending these many colors, right, and working the swell pedals and so forth, and with the technique and so forth, that we make music on the organ. So I learned perhaps more by attending Philadelphia Orchestra rehearsals at Virgil Fox's request than anything else. So Virgil Fox and George Thalben Ball, and of course Herbert von Karajan, the great conductor, I idolized the man. I think he was the great musician.